أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله سيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين ورحمة للعالمين وصلى الله عليه وعلى آله الطاهرين الذين ذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا رزقكم عباد الله بتقوى الله In today's khutbah, I would like to talk very briefly about the concept which is known as the adab and the manners and etiquettes about coming to a masjid. When we talk about Jamaat prayers, especially on Fridays, this is an opportunity where Muslims come to meet one another. And there are certain adab and guidelines given by the Sharia about it. And I would like to begin with the ayat of Quran on this issue where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah number 7, ayat 31, after he talks about the children of Adam, Adam and Hawa being sent to the earth, and the blessings that he has given to them as far as food and means of covering themselves and dress and other things. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Bani Adam, O children of Adam, خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ Where the command is that put on your zinat, your adornment at every place of prayer. So whenever you go, especially when we are talking about a masjid, you know, there are certain things that we have to keep in mind. We are not alone. Praying alone at home is one thing. Praying alongside others is something else. And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, maintain your zenith. And this zenith could be this beauty or adornment applies on physical level, outward level also, and in behavior also. You know, when we talk about physical issue, there are ahadiths that we have that if you're going especially for Friday prayers or Eid Salat, you know, to do ghusl. Now, it might sound something very common these days to take shower, but remember, this is Islam 1400 years ago, where in the West, this concept of bath and taking shower is just about 125 years old, not before that. If you really study the cultural history of Europe, you know, to take a bath was something like a medical treatment. You know, the taking bath was not a common, you know, part of a, you know, a way of life. That is only when people were sick. It is only later on, for example, I remember one a report which was very interesting that in the last decades of the last century, the mayor of London, and apparently in London the mayor has his own mayor's mansion. This is about 100 years ago. He actually put an application in the council so that they can build a shower in the mayor's mansion. And there was this discussion about it, and the conclusion was, since this is not a necessity, we will allow you to build that at your own expense. So you can just realize this was not considered to be, you know, necessary. So Islam is talking about physical cleanliness 1400 years ago, and one of the things about Juma is when you're coming for the congregational prayer is the issue of doing ghusl. The second one, of course, for every Salat, it is recommended to brush the teeth before the Salat, even before the wudu. And, you know, it's interesting that we are told after, before every wudu. If we teach our children to do that, 5 times a day, you know, your expense of going to the dentist, at least the hygienist in the dentist, you know, division, will go down. And this is something which is already there, part of our teachings, is nothing new. Talking about combing the hair, one of the things related to Salat, you know, highly recommended, and of course, putting on perfume. But I would suggest when you go to a public area, be moderate in that. Sometimes, you know, some mu'mineen out of there, you know, low, soak the musalla here with perfume. And the problem I have is that when it goes into my nose, I have a headache right away and becomes a problem in Salat itself. So, you know, you can express your love and respect, but be moderate in using perfume. When we talk about outward zenith, putting on clean clothes when you come to Masjid, there is a hadith from our second imam where Khuthayma bin Abi Khuthayma says, "Kana al-Hasan bin Ali alayhi salatu wa salam." That when the second imam used to go for Salat in the Masjid, يَلْبِسُ أَجْوَدَ ثِيَابِهِ, he would put on the best of his clothes. And somebody commented on that. And they said, يَبْنَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ تَلْبِسُ أَجْوَدَ ثِيَابِكِ, you put on the best of your clothes. And this is where Imam responds by saying, إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلٌ يُحِبُّ الْجَمَالِ, Allah Himself is beautiful and He loves beauty. فَأَتَجَمَّلُ لِرَبِّي, and therefore I also put on, you know, decor myself in that way. وَهُوَ يَقُولُ, and my Lord says, خُذُوا زِينَتُكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ, and He recited this ayat from Surah number 7. فَأُحِبُّ أَنْ أَلْبِسَ أَجْوَدُ ثِيَابِي, and therefore I like to put on the best of clothes that I have, because I'm going in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, when we talk about the physical zenith, we cannot forget the zenith in the behavior. You know, one of the purpose of Jamaat is basically to interact with others on the basis of the Akhlaq, which can be called Akhlaq Hasana. Remember that we come into the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or if you are in the Mambara, you are in the Darbar of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And when you are there in that sense, you know, you have to keep in mind that, you know, we have to also maintain our akhlaq in that way with one another. Whether it is by greeting and salam or by doing musafiha and shaking hands after the namaz. And not only that, if you look at some of the issues as far as things which are disliked when you go into masjid. One of the things is that it is makruh to go to the masjid with the mouth smelling of garlic or onion. If you are alone home, okay, you go in the musalla. Allah doesn't really, He's not bothered about it. But when you go into the masjid, you are with other people, you know, and there is, you ate garlic or whatever, which has smell, then you have to do something to get rid of that before you come into the masjid. And so that shows that we have to basically maintain the things in a way that it does not create problems for others. And so this is akhlaq that we are talking about. Now this is just the smell. What about the words which are hurtful which come out of the mouth? For the garlic, you can put on them, you know, eat a gum before coming into masjid. You know, how do you deal with the foul language coming out? And that is where we have to learn, to restrain our tongue, you know, when we communicate with one another, especially when we are in the masjid with our fellow brethren in faith. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to be among those who fully, you know, implement the teachings of the Quran and the seerah of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad salawatullah alayhi wa jma'in. Since I'm talking about adab of masjid and jama'at, may I please remind the brothers, especially at the back, when we stand up for asr, connection for the ladies. It's really, you know, I feel uneasy to repeat this after every few months. It should be something given, especially those who come every Friday here, that when we stand up for asr prayer, yes, some people do their asr prayer quickly and go back to their work, and so there would be a gap there, and we still have to maintain the connection for the ladies there. And so those who are at the back, if you can move without being told, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, give you jaza for that. You don't have to wait for me to say qad qamat as-salah. There's no hurmat in standing up before those words. You can stand up while the iqamat starts and keep moving, filling the gap which is in the front of you, so that we can have the connection right away when we start the asr prayers. Inna ahsan al-hadith kitabullah al-aziz. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asr inna al-insana lafi khusr illa al-lazina amanu wa amil al-salihat wa tawasaw bil-haqq wa tawasaw bil-sabr. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العطوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه. ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبا. سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة عما سلف من ذنوبكم. In the second khutbah, I have two things I wanted to share with you. One of course is the situation in Syria. As far as the attack on the shrine of Hazrat Hujr bin Adi is concerned, we still are not sure about what happened to the body, but we know the shrine has been destroyed. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep the other holy places intact. Bihaqqi Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. It's interesting to look at the situation in Syria again. It brings me to this theme of, you know, hypocrisy on the world politics. There was a debate just this week in our parliament in Ottawa whether what should be the decision of Canada as far as new developments that they have been hearing about usage of chemical weapons there. And it was interesting to see that all three parties in the parliament did not follow the cry wolf sound coming from the south and some regions of the Middle East. You know, they did not go with that, because even the UN report says that if there is any evidence, although it's not that strong, it is that the rebels have been using that and not the Syrian army. And so, till now, you know, the decision seems to be a wise decision. But this brings up the whole, you know, scenario of hypocrisy. One of the journalists in Canada writing this week you know, puts the whole picture where he says the irony about this situation is there. Today, most of the Western governments, including Canada, they decry Syrian dictator Bashar Assad as a monster. Yet, it was not long ago that Assad was treated by these same governments as a valuable ally in the war against terror. Remember, even we have this case in Canada of Maher Arar, where our government and the security services cooperated with the Syrian government. Those days, you know, Western governments found Assad to be brutally useful. This is a very beautiful description from this journalist. But now he's seen as an embarrassment. You know, and so they would like to get rid of him, but they don't know who will come, so they are not sure about what to do there. And again, I come back to that famous ayat from Surah Baqarah, ayat number 11 and 12, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a different context says, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْعَرْضِ, where it is said to them, do not create mischief on the earth. قَالُوا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ. They say, oh, we are the peacemakers. أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ الْمُفْسِدُونَ. Allah says, they are the actual mischief mongers. وَلَكِنْ لَا يَشْعَرُونَ. You know, they are so much arrogant in what they do that they do not even realize that they are the actual mufsid and they are not muslih. On the positive side, of course, locally here in York region, there is a something, you know, worth sharing with you. We cannot always talk about negativity. The Jewish Defense League wanted to host a person by the name of Pamela Geller. She is an anti-Muslim, anti-Islam activist in U.S. Wherever there is application for, you know, mosque, she would be there, go talking against it. And basically, she is one of those who are so much anti-Islam that they consider all Muslims to be terrorists. And GDL had planned an event with her as the speaker at one of the synagogues in Thornhill. Interestingly, the rabbi of that synagogue is also one of the volunteer chaplains of York Region Police. And when York Region Police found about it, you know, they approached him and they said, you know, if you allow that in your synagogue to go ahead with this speaker, our relationship will be affected because we as an organization do not accept this kind of, you know, anti-minority statements which comes from this lady. And so the rabbi basically, you know, was impressed with the approach by the York Region Police and he canceled. They were renting the basement of the synagogue. Of course, GDL can go somewhere else and do this. But at least this approach by the York Region Police is something we should appreciate, and it is a positive sign as far as, you know, creating harmony in York Region is concerned. Of course, the right-wing media started saying that police threatened the rabbi. You know, that's the term used by the right-wing media against the police. But they were just talking about, you know, the rabbi being a voluntary chaplain in the York Region Police Force, and therefore it would have an implication because they don't want to be connected with these kinds of events. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give wisdom and courage to the people who are wise in this society, and may there be peace all over our country, inshallah. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وعلى إمام المتقين وأمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام وعلى أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان. ما حيا صار البدء والطغيان هادم يا أمنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فل البغي والشقاق. صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتسلت الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.